All right, welcome to our eighth lesson on the Galatians seminar, and we're picking back up with Galatians 3, 1 through 5. And we're particularly looking at verse 4, where Paul says, "Have you suffered so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain?" And so the things that these Galatians were experiencing, they are going to be in vain if they don't remain faithful. And this could possibly refer to Acts 14:19, when there possibly was a physical persecution that arose against the Galatians when they suffered when they first obeyed the gospel. So we recognize that a lot of the persecutions in the early church did come from the hands of the Jews before AD 70. And Paul points out that it's not really in vain that they suffered at the hands of the Jews. And that it is a case that, listen, if you have obeyed the truth, you've obeyed the gospel, yes, you're going to suffer for teaching and obeying the truth. And yes, you may suffer. And as 2 Corinthians 4 talks about, yes, the outward man, you know, it's going to be pressed upon, so to speak, but the inward man is going to be renewed day by day. And we recognize that the suffering, as Paul would say, is for a moment in time. It's only going to last for a little while, but then there's eternal life. But if we turn to doing that which is evil and wrong, and we don't repent of that, then that suffering was really for no purpose, right? Because now you're lost. You're in a lost state. So that's something that we need to recognize in regards to these verses. So he goes back to once again talking about miraculous gifts. So their ability to work miracles was from God through their obedience. Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by works of the law or by the hearing of faith? And obviously, we see that from their own experience, they were able to perform these miracles. And so it's really interesting here, the word supplying, it says he who supplies the Spirit. Definitely that was a word that was used in marriage contracts. So the husband was obligated to, of course, be the provider, supply everything for the wife. So here, Jesus, him being the spiritual husband, he supplies the miraculous gifts necessary to equip his wife, the church, for her sojourn in life. And it's manifest to see that the one supplying the Spirit was also the one working the miracles. So we see the one supplying the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and working miracles was Jesus. So, of course, Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, through the laying on of the apostles' hands, which would be Paul here, who gave the miraculous gifts to the Galatian brethren. And we read this from Ephesians 4, 7 and 8, that Jesus did indeed give miraculous gifts unto men. So, I mean, if we wanted to paraphrase verse 5, Paul is asking this question to them. Did you receive the miraculous gifts that you possess from the Judaizers, those trying to get you to go back to the law of Moses, or from me, an apostle who could lay hands through the New Testament, through the New Covenant? And the answer is obvious. They received them from Paul. So we could construct the logical argument like this. Either the Galatians received the power to work miracles from the Judaizers or from Paul. And the Galatians did not receive the power to work miracles from the Judaizers. Therefore, the Galatians received the power to work miracles from Paul. So you could think about it this way. The Galatian Christians were able to perform miraculous gifts, right? So did those miraculous gifts come from Paul, an apostle who taught the hearing of faith? Or did those miraculous gifts come from the Judaizing teachers who taught the works of the law? Well, obviously, the answer is yes to Paul and no to the Judaizing teachers. Well, then we can keep on going further. Well, if the Galatians received the power to work miracles from Paul, then Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ, because only an apostle could impart miraculous gifts, as we see from various verses in the New Testament. The Galatians received the power to work miracles from Paul. Therefore, Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ. Therefore, Paul, he stands strong for his defense that he is a true apostle. So, it establishes Paul as a true apostle of Christ. And then if Paul is an apostle of Jesus Christ, then his word is the law of Christ, the New Testament, because the apostles have power to bind and loose as his ambassadors. Paul is an apostle of Christ, therefore his word is the law of Christ, the New Testament, because the apostles have power to bind and loose as his ambassadors. So it confirms Paul's word that he was preaching forth the true, genuine gospel and not the Judaizing teachers. Now, you might think of it this way. So maybe one of the arguments that the Judaizing teachers were doing was they were saying, you Galatian brethren, you Gentile Christians, you're not really sons of Abraham. You're not really sons of God. Well, we know the Galatians are sons of God. Well, how do we know that? The proof that they are sons of God is that they had received the miraculous gifts of the Holy Spirit. And from whom did the Galatians receive miraculous gifts? Paul. And then since the Galatians have received the Holy Spirit, these miraculous gifts from Paul, Paul was an apostle of Christ, as he claimed. And since Paul had proved his apostleship, the gospel he preached to the Galatians was the genuine gospel. And the gospel of the Judaizing teachers was another gospel, a false gospel, which was not the gospel of Christ. So, you know, when you think about it, these two questions relate to the same thing. Did you receive the Spirit, or as a metonymy, is what we call it, miraculous gifts by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Or we get the second question, does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Well, obviously, by the hearing of faith. Now, when we think about verses 6 through 9, this is, I think, very important to talk about. So, Paul says, just as Abraham believed God and is accounted to him for righteousness, therefore, know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. So we see the main point of this is that children of Abraham come through the faith. Paul turns to Abraham as that example of one who was saved without keeping the law of Moses. And we're going to really study that from verses 6 through 14. So this is once again another argument Paul is using, the greater than principle. Abraham is definitely great, right? And whatever is not true of the greater is not true of the lesser. Okay, so Abraham was considered righteous because of his faith. We know this from various scriptures. And Abraham received his blessing by the hearing of faith, not by the works of the law of Moses, just as the Galatians had done. And Abraham's faithful obedience put him in good standing with God. So he believed, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. What was accounted to Abraham as righteousness? His faith. He had a true living faith, a faith that was indeed obedient. And it was put on his account. He was righteous in the sight of God. You see, righteousness can denote a right standing before God, in which case Abraham's faith put him in a right standing with God, in which case Abraham's faith resulted in God's righteous acquittal to Abraham. And in Paul's teachings, righteousness is appropriated through the avenue of faith, and it's almost always contrasted with the law-oriented works of righteousness, the works of merit, of works of the law of Moses. So, when we regard this as in the ethical sense, it characterizes the life of obedience that's expected of us who have been baptized into Christ, who have obeyed the gospel, because we also need to understand that we need to live right. We need to live pure lives that are in harmony with God's purpose. And we can see that in various scriptures. So we see that, this declared righteous and practical righteousness, they're not opposed to one another. Because as I like Boyce's comment here, for justification does bring one into a right relationship with God, out of which ethical changes follow. Because we're going to continue to show fruits worthy of a repentance throughout our life. We're going to continue to have that change of heart that leads to a change in action. So, either way, Abraham's faith results in the righteousness, not the observing of the law of Moses. And Abraham was the ultimate example of a Jew to the Jews. And yet, as Paul points out, Abraham was counted righteous on the basis of faith. So the text here in Genesis 15, verse 6, takes place before Abraham. Now notice that it takes place before Abraham was circumcised. So you got Genesis 15, verse 6, and then you got chapter 17, where he's circumcised. So we see, thus, Abraham is a model of justification by faith without circumcision or the law of Moses. And in this respect, he is a model for the Gentiles. Those with the same faith as Abraham are the sons of Abraham. So you can think about those which are of faith is contrasted to those who of the works of the circumcision, the Judaizing teachers, who taught that one becomes a genuine son of Abraham through circumcision and keeping the law of Moses. But since Abraham was justified, since he was considered righteous without circumcision, then Gentiles can be as well, as long as they have the same faith. So this is that like father, like son mentality, basis of the true family of Abraham. So the true children of Abraham is based on faith. It's not based on being a fleshly descendant. You know, the Jews, we know, often appeal to their physical descent, right? They're appealed to their genealogy. But Abraham, being circumcised in Genesis 17, one can be righteous without being circumcised. And the law of Moses, we know, was given several hundred years later. Therefore, one can be righteous without keeping the law of Moses. And what's interesting to me is no right-thinking Jew would deny that Abraham was righteous. Therefore, they accepted one premise of Paul's argument. So it could go like this. If Abraham were righteous when he was uncircumcised and without keeping the law of Moses, then one can be righteous when he is uncircumcised and without keeping the law of Moses. And it's certainly true. That premise is true. Abraham was righteous when he was uncircumcised and without keeping the law of Moses. We find that Genesis 15, verse 6, he was declared righteous by God. It was accounted based on his faith. And then in Genesis 17, we know he was circumcised later. So it's, you know, it's very interesting that therefore, one can be righteous when he's uncircumcised and without keeping the law of Moses. So from this, we learn that Gentile Christians neither have to be circumcised nor that they have to keep the law of Moses in order to be righteous. Now, I want to just go off on a little rabbit trail, if I might. There is, you know, groups that teach that of the binding of this weekly Sabbath on us today. And they'll say that the law of God, which was the moral part of the law of Moses, was in force even from the Garden of Eden, and it's been in force even after that. Well, I want you to think about this. If indeed that law was enforced from Eden, the Sabbath law, then the argument that Paul is giving here is actually not sound. Well, let me show you what I mean by that. You know, the Holy Spirit did not make an unsound argument. We know that the law of Moses was not enforced from Eden. In fact, we're going to look at Nehemiah 9, 13 and 14. You see, Sabbatarians, what they want to do is they separate the law into two parts. They'll say, okay, here's the law of Moses, which is the ceremonial part, which was taken away. But then there's the law of God, which contains the moral aspects of the law. But I want to take you to something I think very interesting to show you that actually that's used interchangeably. And there's other verses we could look at, but this is one of the main ones, I think, that makes it pretty obvious. So this is when Jesus was taken as a baby. And it says to Jerusalem, It says, now when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, notice that, were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to the offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So you see there how that is definitely showing the interchangeability between the law of Moses, who was the mediator, and the law of God, in which God gave the law through Moses. And so these are just used interchangeably. The Ten Commandments indeed are part of the law of Moses, which was done away with. You can look at Romans 7, verse 4 and verse 7 that discusses that matter. So think about it this way. So let's think about the Garden of Eden for a moment. So there's the assertion that the Sabbatarians will claim that the Sabbath law was implemented at that time. And then we have, of course, a couple of thousand years later, there was Abraham. Now, Paul says in Galatians 3:17, this I say, that the law of Moses, which is 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, that was confirmed before by God in Christ, that it should make the promise of no effect. So you see there that after Abraham, 430 years later, would come the law of Moses. Now, what am I trying to say? Well, you go to Nehemiah 9:13-14, and the people the priests say this, talking about God. You came down also on Mount Sinai and spoke with them from heaven, and gave them the just ordinances and true laws, good statutes and commandments. Notice this. You made known to them your holy Sabbath, and commanded them precepts, statutes, and laws by the hand of Moses your servant. You see, the Holy Sabbath was actually made known to the nation of Israel when the law of Moses was revealed at Mount Sinai. It was never given in the Garden of Eden, friends, and that's something we need to recognize. So that if you go back to this argument, you can see now if the law of Moses was was enforced from Eden, then Paul's argument is unsound. But Paul's argument is not unsound. It was a true apostle, and what he states is true, that after Abraham, 430 years later, did indeed come the law of Moses, which contained the Sabbath law. Now, I want to go a little bit further here. Those with the faith of Abraham are the ones blessed by the seed of Abraham. See, God's promise to Abraham included the Gentiles. In you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And what's interesting is the Gentiles, they were not given the law of Moses. And so probably what the Judaizers were trying to do is they were probably trying to use these Genesis passages to justify their own perverted version of the scriptures. And so we see here that God's promise to Abraham did include the Gentiles. Now, notice this. I want to read that part again, if I might. So, in the scripture, verse 8, scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham before, saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. So the good news preached to Abraham was that in him all nations, including Gentiles, would be blessed. And of course, the blessing's ultimate fulfillment is who? It's found in Jesus Christ. So those of faith, not the Judaizers, enjoy the blessings in Abraham. And so the faithful are not only blessed in Abraham, if you look at verse 8, because it says, in you all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, but they are blessed with Abraham, because you look at the very, so then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. So if you think about it here, what we're trying to say, and I'm going to begin here on the left-hand side. See, it's by the hearing of faith, right? That is the way of salvation. Just as Abraham believed God and it was accounted him for righteousness. And then it goes on, we already discussed these arguments for that case. Right? And now what Paul wants to do is he wants to show by the works of the law. Okay, why is it the case that you cannot be saved by the works of the law? And so he says, for as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. And I'm just going to go ahead and read what it says in the Bible here. Are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. So that's something that we need to recognize of what is said there. Okay, so let's talk about this. Let's go into this a little bit deeper, okay? So the justification, if you want to be justified by trying to meet the requirements of the works of the law, this principle is just impossible, Paul points out. You cannot do it. Those who live under the law principle are under the law's curse. Well, why is that the case? Now, we must recognize law is not evil. God placed law for a reason. But you have to recognize that a system that places God in debt to you, saying, oh God, you owe me because I perfectly kept something to humanity, that is wrong. Because, well, one could never really claim that anyway. So there is a curse. Okay, so it's interesting here that the typical Jewish scholar and Judaizers of Paul's day thought that the common people who had neither knowledge of nor interest in the law were already under God's curse. But it's sadly the case that that scholar, the Judaizer, they were placing themselves under the curse, unfortunately. See, the law itself pronounced a curse upon those who did not perfectly keep it. Look what it says again. Cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. I mean, you have to remain faith. You have to obey every single thing all the time. And so that present tense indicates the need for unbroken and continual observance of the whole law. And no one could do that in regards to the law of Moses. So on the basis of the law of Moses, Israel stands condemned under the curse. And if the law placed Israel under the curse, how could it possibly help the Gentiles, right? And that's what Peter is asking at the Jerusalem conference in Acts 15. You remember what he said? Why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our Jewish fathers nor we Jews have been able to bear? Those who rely on works of the law of Moses only succeed and placing themselves under its curse. So, this justification by the law principle and justification by the faith principle, they're total opposites. That you could not find a more totally opposite, diametrically opposed to one another. So, you cannot combine these principles for salvation. It's just not possible. The law itself said that the righteous will live by faith, not law. Now, we know this because Paul points this out. He quotes from Habakkuk, depends on how you want to say it. Habakkuk 2, verse 4, and part of God's, what's going on here when you look at the original context, you'll remember that Habakkuk is very, he's wondering about, okay, why is God using a wicked nation, the Babylonians, to come destroy my nation, the Jews? And he just thinks God is standing idly by, and then God answers his complaint. He says, And I think this is very interesting. The issue is God's use of the wicked Chaldeans to punish Israel. And God's response is to wait, to realize that through his answer may seem slow in coming, it will surely come, and that the righteous shall live by his faith. So in the aftermath of Israel's failure to keep the covenant and the imposition of God's curse through the exile to Babylon, the prophet outlines another path to life for the nation, which is faith. And of course, that faith finds its ultimate expression in who? Faith in Jesus Christ through the gospel, which is how Paul uses Habakkuk 2 verse 4 when you look at Romans 6, 1, 16, and 17. So Israel's options are to either cling to the law, which will result in the curse, or to embrace the Messiah through faith and find life, and therefore they follow in the steps of their father of faith, Abraham. Now, going back to what is said here, the law principle is not the same as the faith principle. We find that in chapter 3, verse 12. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man that does them shall live by them. Okay, this part right here. So let's go. So the law principle is not the same as the faith principle. The law itself said that one is to be who is to be justified by the law principle must keep it perfectly. But no one could. Justification is either by the law principle or by the faith principle, but it cannot be by both. Christ, of course, is the answer to both the law and the justification by faith. Christ came, he came to redeem humanity. And Christ, he actually became the curse for us. So he was made, he was, as it says there, if you want to look, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. So what does that mean? What is this talking about? Well, curse or hanging on a tree does not mean that a person was necessarily cursed by God just because he was hanged or crucified, but that death by hanging or crucifixion was the outward sign in Israel being cursed by God. Now, it's very interesting when you go back to Deuteronomy 21, verse 23. And I want to read this to you because I think this is very insightful. Deuteronomy 21:23. So it says, his body, if a man has committed sin deserving of death and he's put to death and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain overnight on the tree, but you shall surely bury him that day, so that you do not defile the land which the Lord your God has given you as inheritance. For he who is hanged is accursed of God. For he is hanged is accursed of God. Now, you go to Galatians and look what it says there. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Now you go back. And you can see that he is quoting from verse 23. Now, of Deuteronomy 21:23. So, I think it's very interesting here. Having become a curse for us, you see, if you note the middle voice there, it's that Jesus actually caused himself to be hanged, caused himself to be crucified. And this curse is because the person was worthy of death, right? Now, when we think about Jesus, who he is, Jesus did not commit any sin. He did no wrong. And Jesus did not do anything worthy of death. So here's what you have to understand. Jesus was treated as one who had done something worthy of death. In this quote of Deuteronomy 21:23, the words of God, if you look there, are omitted by Paul. You see, it's not there. Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, for he who is hanged is accursed of God. Notice of God is not, it's omitted by Paul. Because Jesus was not cursed of God. Jesus, he was not guilty of sin. He was falsely accused of blasphemy, but that charge wasn't true. And in this manner, Jesus became a curse. He suffered shame on our behalf. He was treated as if he were guilty. In reality, we know he was actually innocent. And this is the only time Paul uses that expression, the curse of the law, although the concept is introduced in verse 10 with respect to Deuteronomy 27:26. And this time, Deuteronomy 21:23 is quoted, which is the original setting, concerning the practice of hanging the dead body of a criminal on a tree as a public warning or perhaps as an additional humiliation. So in both of the Deuteronomy passages cited in Galatians 3, the term curse involves being cut off from the community of God's people, which may have prompted Paul to apply these texts to the current situation. So Christ becoming the curse accomplishes a twofold fulfillment of Abraham's promise. One, justification comes to the Gentiles. Notice that we are actually active in that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Notice that we are active in obtaining that promise. So this is not passive as Calvinism teaches. And the word we, of course, refers both to Jews and Gentiles, all mankind. So we'll pick up with what Jesus was able to accomplish in our next lesson. Really appreciate you being with us. Thank you for your